scripture reading this morning is from the Gospel according to John, chapter 20, verses 1 through 18. Now very early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and saw that the stone had been moved away from the entrance. So she went running to Simon Peter and the other disciples whom Jesus loved and told them, "They have taken the Lord from the tomb, and we don't know where they have put him." Then Peter and the other disciples set out to go to the tomb. The two were running together, but the other disciple ran faster than Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent down and saw the strips of linen cloth lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter, who had been following him, arrived and went right into the tomb. He saw the strips of linen cloth lying there, and the face cloth, which had been around Jesus' head, not lying with the strips of linen cloth, but rolled up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple, who had reached the tomb first, came in, and he saw and believed. For they did not yet understand the scripture that Jesus must rise from the dead. So the disciples went back to their homes, but Mary stood outside the tomb weeping. As she wept, she bent down and looked into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white sitting where Jesus' body had been lying, one at the head and one at the feet. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" Mary replied, "They have taken my Lord away, and I do not know where they have put him." When she had said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Who are you looking for?" Because she thought he was the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have put him, and I will take him." Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned to him and said to him in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Jesus replied, "Do not touch me, for I have not yet ascended to my Father. Go to my brothers and tell them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene came and informed the disciples, "I have seen the Lord," and she told them what Jesus had said to her. May God bless unto us the reading and the hearing of this, his holy word.
Most historians would tell you that it's so important that we understand the past in order to create a future. This morning we gather in what's often called the third triduum. The first triduum was Thursday evening to Friday evening, when the church recognized the time in which Jesus gathered with his disciples in the upper room. And then from dusk on Friday to dusk yesterday, we recognized Holy Saturday. And then from yesterday's dusk to this evening's dusk, the third part of the triduum has to do with the Easter vigil and Easter Sunday morning. And so here we are, celebrating, reading the Holy Scripture, hearing the story of John's writing, what happened on that first Sunday. We've heard about Mary early in the day, in the dark, coming to the tomb, stone rolled away, body missing, running to the disciples to proclaim, the disciples coming in this foot race, one beating the other, the second one going in, and then the one who got there first goes in, and they look around, they see the wrappings. Then Mary stays while the other disciples return to their home, and she weeps. She too looks in the tomb, sees angels, doesn't recognize them. They ask, "Why are you weeping?" Again, she says, "I don't know where they've taken him, but he is gone." And she turns around, and Jesus is standing there. She doesn't recognize him. He asks her again, "Why are you weeping?" And then asks, "If you have him, if you know, please let me know so I can take care of his body." And then he simply says, "Mary." And she looks to him and recognizes Jesus and says, "Rabboni," meaning teacher. And then she wants to hug him. Natural response. Backing off and says, "You cannot hang on to me, but go and tell the disciples that I am going to be ascended to go to my Father and your Father, my God and your God." I look at this passage as a time of great stress and great anxiety, particularly for Mary in her Jewish community. Mary was just doing what was natural, wanting to come to grips with the sorrow. This homage was natural, as anyone would reach out and search and weep for a loved one who's missing. I think of the culture in which Mary grew up, highly regulated. Last time I heard a report, there are over 6,000 particular laws that Jewish people keep in their religious tradition and culture. And Mary was a part of this highly regulated society. And for my own interest in sharing with you today, I thumbed through the book of Numbers. And I found a scant few of them. Laws that have to do with observance and clothing and food and days of the week and neighbor relations and cleanliness of personal hygiene and the vows and the offering and the feast and the songs and how to relate to death and purification and duties and Sabbath and sin, and the list goes on and on and on. Mary, in these moments, begins to discover what it means for her to stay in place, in the circle, in the tradition of her culture. She gradually understands that there is an evolution of life happening here, and it's taking time. And it's not very comfortable because the repetitions of her life and her culture, her community, were being altered. She had lost her best friend. So she was entering into what we could call the liminal space. And if liminal is the new word for you, it comes from the Latin, pronounced limen. It means threshold. It's this space between what you are leaving behind, moving through this threshold, and are in the process of making new discoveries. So there's this transitional space that Mary finds herself in. Liminal space for her is this crucial moment in her journey of faith as a faithful Jewish woman. She's in the midst of finding out what it means to let go and let God. Moving through this liminal space, this threshold of experience, she's into uncharted territory, saying, whatever's going to happen is going to happen. Que sera, sera. So she's on a vast learning curve here. She's mindful of her situation and the people around. She has some trouble connecting the dots. But yet she's paying attention, even though she has many more questions than answers. She seeks out those about her and has conversation with them having to do with what was happening to her in the midst of this most uncomfortable situation and uncertainty. Her life in these moments is filled with a lot of ambiguity. But she is beginning to know what it means to observe, to grasp, to listen with a critical ear. She gradually understands that it's time to accept a new event, accept this transformation that's already taken place. And so she too lets herself listen and be transformed by believing in the resurrection. And in the end, she hears her name. She acknowledges Jesus as teacher, and then she goes to the other disciples and she proclaims, I have seen the Lord. So after this period of struggle and wonder and doubt and perplexity, she's gone through some evaluation and she's judged the situation correctly for herself. She celebrates the liveness of Jesus. Jesus, who loved her unconditionally and who would always, always be with her. In this liminal space, she came to the time to accept, Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And she announced to the community, Christ the Lord is risen. Jesus is the resurrection and the life. And I probably had one of those high, high experiences several years ago when I was with a group of about 30. We were peacemakers. We traveled to the Soviet Union a couple times. And in that second journey, for about 2 weeks in length, we were given tickets to the Bolshoi, that grand, huge, significant opera house in Moscow. We attended, and it was as impressive and fantastic and inspiring than beyond what I had ever imagined. And then about 11 o'clock in the evening, boarding our chartered bus, we asked about how the Russian Orthodox Church would be celebrating Easter on that Saturday. We as Christians from the Americas had celebrated Easter the week before, and theirs is often delayed at least a week or two. And our tour guide said, Will, there's a grand celebration in one of the very large downtown churches in Moscow. If you would like to go there, I would take you. So about 11 o'clock in the evening, we said, yes, we would like to see how the Russian Orthodox Church does it. And within a minute, there were at least four or five police cars around our bus, red, white, and blue lights flashing ahead of us, and soon about a dozen police motorcycles were ahead of them with lights flashing, and we were being given an escort to this large church. And we came to traffic lights and we went right through and the police stopped the traffic. And mile after mile, we were given this entourage. And at first I thought there must be a huge accident somewhere, but it was all for us. And then when we arrived at the church, the great, huge, large, round wooden doors, very thick, were closed. So they escorted us into the side doors, and there we found the great cavern of a cathedral, a huge dome, darkened, and people pressed in, like if you were riding a subway car in Tokyo, shoulder to shoulder, chest to chest, back to back, men, women, and children, all holding tiny little skinny candles. So we wiggled our way to the back and tried to stay together as a group. I was tall enough to look over the tops of most people. In this dimly lit sanctuary, I thought I saw at the dais, at the chancel area, Orthodox priests, young men and old, black beards, black robes, moving left and right slowly, speaking, reciting, sounded like mumbling to me, some chanting, reading from the scriptures, reading from their memorization, moving slowly back and forth. And then about midnight, eight more priests came in from the side, a large slab on their shoulders, and a body of Jesus laying out. And they slowly moved into the center, chanting. And we were there probably a couple hours standing with all these people. No pews at all in the entire sanctuary. They continued to read. They continued to swing their incense containers. This bluish haze filled the sanctuary, sweet in color. Then after a little bit, came at least 1 o'clock in the morning, and we started to talk to each other and realized that this worship experience is going to go on until sunrise, and we're not so sure we can take it. So, we stayed for a little while and then made our way to the door and to the bus and went back to our hotel about 2 a.m. But before we left, we were informed that at sunrise, a Jesus would appear at the front of that sanctuary and people would light their candles and shout, "Hallelujah!" Shout, "Christos Voskres, Vostanu Voskres!" Christ is risen, Christ is risen indeed! And they would shout and boo and sway and sing, and the Christ would make his way down the central aisle to those vast doors that would slowly open, and he would make him way out into the street with the crowds following. And so as I experienced this live depiction of Easter and the celebration within that country, year by year, I think of the Church of Jesus Christ today. All the sunrise services, all the Easter vigils, all the preparation within the triduum of the last 3 days. And I think of the mighty power of the church celebrating one who rose victorious over death, even celebrating here this morning as we too identify with Christ's resurrection. And so, as the scripture concludes, Mary went to the disciples and began the proclamation. And so too, in the ministry and the witness of the Church of Jesus Christ, we carry on that grand tradition. And let us, as we eventually return to our home and our community and our culture, and as we continue to minister here, others would sense and feel the aliveness of Christ in our lives and in our good works together. Amen.